Good afternoon, and welcome to another concert on San Diego's unique and historic Spreckels Outdoor Pipe Organ. My name is Dale Sorensen. I serve as your organ curator. If you're viewing our online presentation for the first time, you might be interested in a brief history of the instrument. Both the organ and the building were a gift of the Sugar heirs, Adolph B. and John D. Spreckels. The organ was first played on New Year's Eve, ushering in 1915, at the opening ceremonies of the Panama, California Exposition that was held here in Balboa Park. The organ has been in continuous use these past 105 years. The instrument was originally built by the Austin Organ Company of Hartford, Connecticut. When first installed, it contained 46 ranks. Now, through subsequent additions, it contains 80 ranks, or over 5,000 pipes. The largest pipes are 32 feet in length, the smallest about the size of a pencil. All the sounds you hear are natural sounds produced by compressed air energizing pipes or actual percussion instruments being struck by organ mechanism. There is no electronic tone generation or amplification of the organ at all. These programs are presented throughout the year, every Sunday from 2 to 3 by the City of San Diego Park and Recreation Department in cooperation with the Spreckels Organ Society. The Spreckels Organ Society is a volunteer grassroots group that has come together to preserve, program, and promote this unique world treasure. If you're here on a Sunday, we have gold boxes that the audience can contribute to, but with the virus quarantine and Balboa Park being closed down, we're obviously not able to do that. But Spreckels Organ Society relies on the generous donations of the viewers and members, and so we do have a donate button on the website. Donate or join. You're welcome to join the 1,200, almost 2,000 members of the Society if you believe in the work that's happening here at the Spreckels Organ Pavilion. So click on the donate button, the join button, and there are instructions there to follow that you can donate there. And memberships actually start at $5,000 and go down very rapidly from there. So it's level of commitment. Today you're wondering perhaps, okay, where's Waldo? Where's Dale today? Well, today we're up on top of the expression boxes of the organ. When we added the new percussions, right here we have the harp, and it's big, it takes room, and there really was not room inside the expression chambers. So we said, okay, up on the roof. And we said that they're a genuine percussion instrument being struck by organ mechanism. So we have metal bar harp with sympathetic resonators, and they look like piano hammers that actually hit the harp. The air pressure makes the hammers move. Behind, you can swing around, you can see the xylophone. I won't cut in front of that. That's actually a rosewood bars with small resonators, sympathetic resonators, hit by wooden strikers. So it's a very woody sound, and you've heard that played repeatedly in the organ. Well, this is your chance to get to see it. It's quite a harrowing climb up here, so don't plan on coming up in person anytime soon. Last week I mentioned that the air supply for the centennial tuba is coming from above. We saw the wind lines. Here are the reservoirs for that. I hit the switch for the high pressure blower, and there they've inflated. If I shut the blower off, you'll see there it goes down. This will be going down. And the air is channeled down to the chest below. If you look up, you can see we've talked sometimes in tours and so forth about the parabolic shaped ceiling up here. We're kind of at the apex, the high point of it here, and you can see it goes down and it's shaped as a reflecting shell. And this catches the sound of the organ and pushes it on out. We're actually above the facade. No lights are on down there today. The biggest pipe is about 4 feet below me, the top of it. We're at the top of the arch over the organ. You can see across the top here is the top of the big steel door, which is now closed for the Sunday. We recorded the music on Thursday night. And the big transmission to run, it's back there in the corner. And it's all this stuff working together makes for a concert. And it wouldn't be a good concert if we didn't have a fine artist. And so let's turn you over to our civic organist, Raul Prieto Ramirez, and we're ready for a concert.
One of the most picturesque music pieces written for organ during the Spanish Baroque are those called batallas. For decades, music historians have pitcher, they have pitcher, those batallas as a representation of the military power of the Spanish Empire of the 15 and 1600s. And the same thing was done to the facade of the typical Spanish Baroque organs, where those horizontal trumpets has been pictured by music historians in the past as some kind of music weapon, some kind of cannons shooting loud notes to be heard from the farther away corners of the Spanish Empire. Although these stories would make a very best-selling novel or a very beautiful, very exciting movie, in fact, they are kind of far from reality. Regarding the batallas, they were actually a French creation, a French Flemish creation. The first one we know was written by the French composer Clément Jeannequin with the name La Guerre, the War. And as Spanish Austrian rulers start being the kings of Spain, starting by Charles I, they brought with them an army, really a big number of French and Flemish composers who were so influential in Spain that they established the standard for high quality music. So for La Guerre, the war from Clément Jeannequin became like a great hit in all the Austrian territories, not only Spain, but also the Austrian country and so forth. Composers start writing pieces that represent wars because everybody knew La Guerre from Clément Jeannequin, so they wanted to capitalize in popular music for themselves. So that's how battles, these batallas, made their way into the musical scene in Spain, and so they did in Austria. So we have examples of Austrian composers writing batallas as well as they do in Great Britain. And regarding those horizontal trumpets in the facade of the Spanish organs, those were actually an Italian influence. Italians are very well known for their pragmatic mindset. So many contracts in the Baroque period state that organists were supposed to tune the trumpets of the organs on a weekly basis. And they were not really willing to pay someone else to hold the notes where they were tuning. So a very good solution that started in Italy is to bring those trumpets to the front of the organ so the organist can put a little weight, like a little rock, on the key while he would tune the trumpets one after the other just from the keyboard. And that's how the Spanish reeds became horizontal above the keyboard, so the Spanish organist on a weekly basis, they could hold notes and tune them at the same time. So it's just a matter of practical use. So although those stories explained by music historians in the past decades sounds like more exciting, they are definitely far from reality, which is more driven by practical and economic reasons. So although being less exciting, I find them much more interesting. So now please let all enjoy together this famous battaglia from an unknown composer.
Thank you.
after Franz Liszt's failure to marry the Princess Caroline zu Sayn-Wittgenstein and the death of two of his son Daniel and his daughter Brandine, Franz Liszt retreat to a monastery outside Rome in 1862. While there, he got to know about a publication made by musicologist Dietz that included a fake Ave Maria by Renaissance composer Jacques Arcadelt. It was actually a three voices motet to which Dietz adapted the lyrics of the Ave Maria, maybe with the intention of make the music more widely performed by being an Ave Maria than a motet like Nous voulions les hommes, I think are the lyrics. So Franz Liszt got to know this new Ave Maria, new discovered Ave Maria while he retreated in this monastery. And he wrote this beautiful piece both for piano and for organ, which is a kind of an arrangement of this Ave Maria. The piece has been nicknamed Bells of Rome because it starts with a musical motif that obviously resembles or imitates the bells. But I actually disagree a little bit. I understand Bells of Rome because he was actually living outside Rome in a monastery. But I find that with this piece of music, Liszt, in a very difficult moment in his life, he let his imagination fly and lead his creativity. And for me, the way I approach this music, and from here, this is nothing you will find in any book, this is my own approach. It is like Franz Liszt walking along the countryside, around the monastery one afternoon while retreat in that monastery. And at the beginning, we can listen the bells far away and the voices, those voices in the distance singing this beautiful fake Ave Maria by Arcadelt. As he approaches the monastery, those voices are clearer and clearer until a forte, a very emotional forte with one of the most important moments in this music. And after this very emotional climax gets really into Franz Liszt's soul, the music dissolves back into those bells and those voices in the distance as Franz Liszt leaves the monastery in his back as he continues his walk through the countryside outside Rome. It's really like a walk, like a little journey along the countryside around Rome while his retreat with this beautiful emotional music resounding with the bells in the distance in his head. So I really invite all of you to close your eyes and let your soul travel with me to the countryside outside the beautiful city of Rome with this fake but amazingly beautiful Ave Maria from Arcadelt as filtered through the soul and the imagination of the great 19th century German-Hungarian composer Franz Liszt. And that's all for today's concert. I hope you all enjoy being here in Balboa Park with us, even if you have to do that from the comfort or of your own home. So you know Balboa Park is open, but the concerts at the Organ Pavilion are not gonna happen for a while until we are authorized to do so. But while that time arrives, we're gonna be here producing these concerts online for all of you to enjoy. Please consider hitting that thumbs up button in the YouTube platform, because that's the way YouTube actually decide which videos are worth promoting or worth showing or proposing, show as a proposal for other viewers in the platform. So if you want to help us promote the great music in the Kings of Instrument, hitting that thumbs up button is really important for our goal. Also, if you want to be on top of the concerts we upload regularly, you may consider subscribing to the channel. And in any case, on the website of the Spreckels Organ Society, or even here in the description of your video, you can do two important things. One of them is vote. Vote for the piece of music that you like, that you enjoy the most today. Number one, because you provide me with information that I can use to plan future concerts. And number two, because the number one vote from the audience today will be repeated next week, which is a way for you to come back and enjoy the music you actually enjoyed the previous week. And the second reason is because if you want to help the Spreckels Organ Society continue surviving and continue promoting and protecting this world landmark instrument, as well as promoting and developing the educational program, as well as the concerts and the Summer Organ Festival, you may consider a donation for this program, something you can do in the description of the video here below, as well as in the website of the Spreckels Organ Society. So until next week, when we will be here with more great music for all of you to enjoy, please be good and stay healthy and be well. Thank you very much.